received the bodies of 33 relatively young men. The vast majority of these prisoners died of real severe blunt injury, a good deal of it on the head. In some cases, we have combinations of blunt injuries and incised injuries. Obviously, the person who was cutting this individual's throat was not the same one who was hitting him with a bar.
And the last time we went to see him, my brother asked him, "Abba, when will you be getting out here?" And he said, "I think the time that I get out of here will be in a coffin."
The prophecy of Joe A. Madrid, inmate number 25940, was fulfilled here at the New Mexico Penitentiary near Santa Fe, when in the early morning of February 2nd, 1980, this prison exploded. For the next 36 hours, uncontrolled terror behind the walls, as over 1,000 convicts took over the penitentiary. 12 guards were taken hostage. Over 100 inmates were seriously injured. 33 inmates were murdered. For the next hour, we will be making a journey through those 36 hours of wildness while we learn what circumstances, immediate and then deeper, help set the fury loose.
From Algie Munoz and Hester Medina,
the
Tiger.
I'd like to dedicate this song to Dolly Nez over there in the female division.
I dedicate everybody to be the one.
Be one.
What's happening there, you two? Hope you're staying out of trouble.
And do a Buddy Holly one for me.
Every day, it's getting closer. Faster than a roller coaster, love like yours will surely come my way. Hey, hey, hey.
A lot of these kids got raped in there. A lot of them got beat. A few of them got stabbed. And the administration never stopped us.
The strong survive. It's the laws of the jungle.
The yelling and the screaming at men and the beatings, bringing the dignity of a man down to nothing.
Packing people in prison like sardines with nothing at all to do but sit around and realize how miserable everything is. And that frustration builds up for years and years and years.
When you throw all of these men together into one institution, treat them all with the same kind of repressive, oppressive, demeaning, demoralizing psychological atmosphere, it creates a nest of resentment, hate, hostility. And when you have that kind of an admixture, it sets the stage for violent upheaval.
Was the scene of the most savage prison riot in the nation's history. Here, prisoners murdered and viciously assaulted each other. This riot occurred in a state prison that is not typical, that is certainly among the nation's worst. But in examining the reasons for this eruption, we also hope to show the enduring ills common to much of the whole nation's prison system. The rage and barbarism in the New Mexico penitentiary present a classic story, a nightmare world set apart, a class structure patterned on brutality and informers, a small clique of supervisors who presided over this prison community as a private preserve, and the bluff indifference of governing authorities who were undisturbed even by a series of reports that the prison was shortly to blow apart. Not for a moment should the inmates' behavior be excused. We can't show you what some men did to others. Their actions were so savage. Even so, We warn you in advance, what you will see is strong and disturbing evidence of the fury unleashed during a prison riot. It must be shown if the full story is to be told and understood.
Brutalization begets brutalization. Violence begets violence. In Santa Fe, we had a system of penology with a mentality of penology, which is all punishment. When you take everything away from a human being, including his personal individual dignity, when he has nothing left to lose, they become extremely dangerous.
The penitentiary at Santa Fe, built in 1955, designed for 850 prisoners, overflowing at the time of the riot with 1,156 men. In these squat cement wings, young convicts on minor offenses jammed in with killers and rapists. Racial tension between Black, Chicano, Anglo, and a mostly Chicano prison staff. 16 guards were on duty inside the prison the night of the riot, less than half the number working at other prisons with similar populations. Overcrowded, understaffed, primed to explode.
ID, I'm 47163, report to ID office.
The prison control center, the keys and gate controls were here. The nerve center, the security hub of this prison. At 1:30 a.m. February 2nd, that security fell apart. Three guards were locking the day room of dormitory E2 in the south wing. One guard routinely holds the keys outside the dorm, and two others go inside, patrol, and lock up. Suddenly, one inmate leaped from a bed, grabbed the still open door. At the same moment, a group of inmates overpowered the other guards. The takeover had begun.
These dudes are saying, hey, we're taking it over, man. Get your pants on. Come on, we need help, you know?
A group of inmates raced toward the control center, intending to smash through the shatterproof glass.
We went to the shower window, which overlooks the control cell. I saw an inmate with a mop bucket ring off, hitting the glass. Next thing I know, there was a hole in the glass. I saw the guard in the control center run out the back door.
You could hear glass breaking and screaming and people running and hollering at each other. It sounded like a stampede.
Went to the wall, got the riot sticks and the riot batons, which are like small softball bats. And they started passing them out to the other inmates in the hallway.
People started hitting the canteen and they started hitting the pharmacy. And then pills were everywhere. I mean, you know, everybody's getting loaded and tearing this thing all to pieces, making weapons out of chairs and, you know, every kind. They hit the butcher shops. You know, hey, just rampaging all over the thing, you know?
There was about 20, 30 people came up in the hallway into our dormitory. They had a shoebox full of pills. And I guess they had maybe 50, 75 syringes. And they started passing them out. And just one big shooting gallery. Almost every inmate I seen had a weapon in his hand, either a piece of pipe, a piece of bed rail, a knife, or some homemade weapon.
People started streaming out and breaking for that hallway, and hey, 5 minutes later, they had the whole penitentiary.
Within 2 hours, the inmates had control of the prison. They had lived in a world operating on the darkest levels of man's nature. And when that world broke loose, it began to devour itself with the same blind ferocity.
People were starting to die. Dead bodies starting to show up here and there. You know, a guy hanging on a door with a screwdriver through his head. You know, guys beat all to pieces. Their heads beat all, you know, just to a mush. Stabbing them, you know. And, you know, hey, it was scarier than hell. Dudes walking, you know, we were walking up front, and I got a little bit separated. And, boom, I bumped into somebody in the smoke. And then the next thing I know, I'm getting stuck. Boom, stuck here and there, and bam, steel rods are coming down on me. And I see, it was a meat cleaver come in, and I stuck my hand up, and cut that cleaver, and it just cut right through here, you know, through the bone and everything, and the hand just went, and I went about halfway down, and was getting stuck, and
beat on. I took, I don't know, about 300 or 400 stitches to sew up my head.
Fires were set. Inmates found cutting torches in the prison plumbing shop. The torches were first used to cut through the hardened steel bars to reach prisoners locked inside. Then the torches were used as murder weapons as prisoners took revenge against fellow inmates.
The guy that came out that was burned with the torch burned right through to his skull. His head apparently had exploded in the back because of the pressure of the heat and everything. And you can just see the terror on what was left of his face at what he went through.
Much of the violence was directed against prison informants and misfits housed in cell block 4.
You heard of a shark going, you know, when he smells blood into a frenzy? That's why it was there, you know?
The rampage would continue for 36 hours. The violence of this riot, inmate against inmate, baffled many. But there were reasons for the savagery. We will explore that as we continue. Death in a Southwest prison. These are the faces of prisoners within a prison, isolated from other inmates for their own protection. According to the Attorney General's investigation, officials of the prison knew from the outset that killings of inmates by inmates would occur once these cell blocks were opened. The focus of the worst violence was cell block 4, the protective custody unit. Housed here were prison informants and those whose crimes were abhorrent even by convict standards.
They cut him all to pieces with a cutting torch. Yeah, well, he deserved that 100 times more. You know, a baby raper or whatever you want to call him, a child molester, yeah, well, hey, that's a sick individual, and he's got anything coming that anybody does to him. You know, whoever did that ought to get a metal pin on their chest.
Violent words and actions are common inside prisons, but in New Mexico, the rioters acted with uncommon ferocity. What could have goaded them to such extremes? The background to that story was years of political impassiveness to the prisoners' lot there, political inattention to how the prison was administered, and to what went on inside.
The immediate causes we found were conditions not too different from those in state prisons elsewhere. Brutality, incompetence, overcrowding, understaffing. But here we also found a particularly perverse practice encouraged by New Mexico prison officials of inmates informing on one another for special privileges.
Inmates who informed on other inmates were called snitches. To most of the convicts, they were traitors and collaborators.
The dude that sent me to the penitentiary for life or something was sitting over there, you know, doing 6 months. You know, I'm sitting here doing a life and I got a chance to get to that dude. Yeah, well, bet. You know, hey, I'm gonna break my back trying to get that boy.
Most prisons use inmate informants, but here the system was more widespread, more deliberate.
Well, you got a guy that they want to turn into one of their snitches, one of their informers. They'll first approach him to it and he won't go for it. Tell him, no way. So they'll take him and throw him in with a bunch of hard timers.
Trace Guy spent 17 years in the prison at Santa Fe on 2 counts of armed robbery.
Knowing that they're going to beat him, they're going to rape him and everything else. Then when he gets out of the hospital, the captains, lieutenants tell him, all right, you do what we want to, and we'll keep him away from you. They use that a lot for their informants and everything, especially the young guys.
They are very much individuals who, as a Judas, have sold their soul for their own protection to the administrative setup. That's why the violence against them.
I don't know why they had to do that to him. Leaving his head like an inflated ball, all smashed.
Joe Madrid, known as King of the Snitches, was among the first and most gruesomely murdered. His mother and sister are now suing the state of New Mexico for $1 million, alleging they failed to protect him during the riot.
Do you know why he was killed?
No. I don't know why, because he never killed anybody.
The papers that you filed said that he was an informer.
That's what they wrote down, but I don't know. It's hard to believe. If he was, they should have taken more good care of him.
When you create a system that thrives on the use of the snitch system and physical abuse and cruelty, you assume that you're going to be able to keep control at all times. But when you lose control and you have fostered an ethic amongst inmates, an ethic that creates rapes, beatings, and murders amongst inmates, you've got to be responsible for it when you lose control and the inevitable takes place.
There have been 5 dead bodies that have come out of here of inmates so far. There have been none with regards to the staff at this point in time. We continue, as mentioned before, to carry on continuous negotiations with the men there.
Inside, inmates still raged against their fellow prisoners. We do not know all of the story because we were barred by state officials from talking to some inmates still in the prison and to guards involved in the riot. But it is clear that the incompetence of the staff played a key role in making the uprising possible. Doors, crucial for security, were left open that night.
When they're taking count at night, you've got 2 grills in the institution that are supposed to be closed. You've got the south end grill and the north end grill. And if the south end grill would have been closed like it was supposed to be, the riot itself would have been confined to the south end. The grill wasn't closed.
That's a violation. It's a cardinal sin, as a matter of fact, in a penitentiary to operate a place this way. There's a number of staff there that they've never been trained. They don't really understand the importance of locking both of those grills. They think it's just a lot of extra work.
We obviously didn't think that we would have the problem of the riot and the takeover, and had it not been for this particular glass that had been placed with the last year or so in the control center, well, they would not have gotten but about one cell block.
Another security error on the part of the administration, replacing steel bars around the prison's control center with glass. From that command center, the staff controls access to the entire facility. Once the inmates broke the glass and took the center, they had control of the entire penitentiary.
We got bars there again now.
But glass looks better.
Yes, glass looks better. We had bars. They took bars out and put glass, and the prisoners obviously watched this, and they obviously realized that that wasn't too substantial.
Just after the sun came up this morning, the inmates set fire to the north end of the prison again. Huge columns of black smoke poured up, started to turn white. The situation through the night, as we monitored the two-way radio communications between the inmates and prison authorities, indicated that things were going very badly inside the prison.
And you've also changed the official body count, is that correct?
Yes, there's 8 bodies now.
Another persistent problem in prisons across the country, overcrowding. In Santa Fe, hundreds more inmates than the prison was designed to house. The rage and anger builds.
And you're just packed in, and everywhere you turn, you know, somebody's, their feet stink, you know, and there's about 6 inches between you and the next bed. You can't even move your arm over without hitting somebody in the face. And you got all these radios and things on different stations at full volume. And all of these people are packed in a place. I mean, you know, it's a madhouse.
When I got here in 77, I was sleeping on the floor.
Me too. Man. I slept on the floor too for about 2 months.
Slept on the floor.
Throw a mattress right there, share to this guy's desk, and you sleep right
during
there.
During the day, you slide the mattress under this bed so you can walk around.
There might be certain people that you don't get along with. The thing with the homosexual acts that you're watching at night, the crawling through the floors in the middle of the night, the screams.
These conditions were no secret, as correspondent William Sherman learned.
More than 12 grand jury investigations on prison conditions have been made public and circulated to state legislators over the last 6 years. Grand jury inspections of the penitentiary are mandated by law, and the reports charged that the prison was jammed beyond capacity, had too few guards with too little training, and that there were insufficient psychological, medical, and rehabilitative services. The American Civil Liberties Union has also filed numerous suits charging that inmate civil rights have been repeatedly violated. Add to this grim picture the brutality of guards against inmates, a routine of torment that helped trigger the riot.
And they would go in and have shakedowns and throw his pictures of his children and his wife on the floor and walk on them for no reason at all other than the fact they just, you know, regarded that person as an inmate or a convicted criminal, and I'm a guard, so I don't have to explain.
They put you in a stripped cell and keep you down in the hole or solitary.
It's a 9x6 cell, and it has an oriental toilet for inmates who obviously are suicidal or may hurt themselves while they're in that cell.
Yeah, but it's not unnecessarily cruel in your view.
It's not. It's a control, strictly used for control, yeah, to protect them or other inmates.
That you've got seven men thrown in there with one hole in the ground, and you have to eat in this place. There's no ventilation. You have a jug of water where everybody shares it. You have to use the restroom in front of seven people, and if they don't want to flush the toilet outside, they won't flush it. And this is what frustrates me the most, is because I can take it, but there's a lot of individuals that are unable to take it, and the lid flies up, and pretty soon you've got guards coming in beating on these guys.
And they come in a group and cuff you up and beat you
with sticks.
Those real long night sticks, too, so they don't have to get too close. There's some ones that are about 3-4 feet long. And if you were up at the riot, you'd have seen them.
As for overall blood and guts, there was certainly a fair share of it out there at the penitentiary. We had all six of our ambulance helicopters out there, and it seemed like there was business enough for all of them. I never saw some of the things in Vietnam that I saw here.
I was in the NOM for 2 years, and like I've seen some hellacious sights over there. And it's my personal opinion and belief that these inmates out there made Vietnam look like a playground.
I think the overriding picture that I got was rage. Just absolute unbelievable rage. I've been exposed to all kinds of murder victims. And I worked in the Guyana episode. I saw, you know, hundreds of dead bodies and helped process them. I didn't come away with nearly as sick feeling from that as I did from this.
The destruction that the human body is capable of, unless one person's seen it, they can't even begin to comprehend what happened out there. When I think about it now, you know, I just like to sit down and cry about it sometimes. It's a heavy mind trip, man.
What incredible slackness of the authorities could have allowed this to happen? We will turn to that question in a moment.
The situation at best is out of control, but contained. National Guard troops and police have surrounded the prison, 125 armed officers. There are 80 inmates believed to be involved in this riot. They have burned the administration building and the psychiatric area. 13 guards are being held hostage.
Oh, my brother's dead!
The ones that aren't listed!
You're worried about
how do we know where they're at?
About our families.
The negotiations are definitely still going on.
Mr. Rodriguez, and see if I could get approval, if I could get some guys to get them dead people out of there. Right now, while we're sitting here, there's probably killing going on now.
We found that the underlying causes of that killing and of the riot itself can be traced to the administration of the prison. We found a pattern of ceaseless turnovers in high prison jobs. This makes stability and control of the prison at higher state levels virtually impossible. We found, too, that for years, a clique of middle-level management personnel has dominated the prison and outmaneuvered a succession of bosses. Incompetence on the part of the administrators, indifference on the part of the politicians, help create the climate in which the butchery began. Take the turnover of top prison administrators, all political appointees. In the past 10 years, seven secretaries of correction have come and gone. Wardens of the penitentiary have also come and gone, five in the last 6 years. Felix Rodriguez, removed as warden, but kept in the department. Ralph Aaron, forced to resign. Clyde Malley, quit in disgust. Levi Romero, transferred to another state government post. Jerry Griffin, transferred to another department post. And now, Felix Rodriguez, back as acting warden. Throughout this turnover of political appointees, the middle management clique retained real control. Its members were known as the Santa Fe 11. Entrenched and undersupervised, they ran the prison. Prisoners cooperated or suffered the consequences.
There was a group of officers there who'd grown up together. These guys came home from World War II or from the Korean War, and the major industry in Santa Fe was the Department of Corrections. And a group of them got in there, 1953, 1954, and stayed there. Felix was the father. He was the paternal, benevolent dictator of the penitentiary.
Felix Rodriguez is the most powerful man in corrections in New Mexico. He started as a guard in the 50s. By 1970, he was warden. Another key member of the clique, Deputy Warden Robert Montoya. He's outlasted five wardens since 1975. Montoya was the special target of the rioters' rage.
They characterized him that they would give up the riot and give up the hostages the minute we gave them Robert Montoya. You know, they hated the man. They want him dead.
You were one of their demands during the riot.
Right.
They wanted your hide.
I'm the man that has to enforce the rules and regulations of the facility. I'm the man that has to say no to many things within the facility. And I feel they're honest no's.
After the riot, Montoya was charged with brutality by the Attorney General and removed from his prison post. But his career doesn't seem to have suffered.
There were mitigating circumstances, I think, that caused that incident. I consider the incident serious enough so that I would not allow Bob Montoya to work in a capacity where he would deal with inmates in the future. I intend to try to place Bob Montoya in another state agency as soon as we can develop a job that can use the other administrative abilities that he has.
Well, the report says not only did he slap an inmate, but that he also forced another inmate to take off his shoes and then stomped on the inmate's feet.
The incident of making a man take off his shoes and then stomping on them seems to be somewhat more of a considered judgment.
That is the reason why I would not condone that type of treatment, and we removed him from that position.
Due to interference from outside forces, either political or otherwise, usually political interference, wardens were not able to carry out the job the way they felt that they should carry it out, and they should have had the full confidence and support of a governor to have just gone in there and clean house and gotten rid of the clique instead of the clique getting rid of the warden.
Neither Robert Montoya nor Felix Rodriguez would agree to be interviewed for this program.
There are at least 10 people, all of them inmates, reported dead. There's one guard who was inside that they have not been able to contact. The other guards who were among the hostages have all been at least seen or talked to by prisoners who have surrendered and come out.
Our investigation found that staff corruption was another underlying problem at the prison. There was ongoing traffic in drugs. And this was known as long ago as 1975, when former Attorney General Anaya investigated the prison.
Not only were the guards aware, for example, of the narcotics trafficking, but some of the guards and some of the higher-ups had to be actually participating in the actual trafficking itself. It simply could not go on to the extent that it was going on without the actual involvement by officials.
When you were warden, were there guards bringing drugs into the prison?
Yes, we found several. We had a problem. We talked to the officials downtown about it. I was told at a later date, not too long before I resigned, that don't worry about it. Particularly if the guy was a Chicano, you're not going to get him convicted.
Why weren't they arrested?
That's a good question.
Failure to prosecute has been a constant pattern. Records show 5 guards fired for possession and drug dealing in the past 18 months, but not a single prosecution. And drug sales continued.
If you want weed, pay the price, you can get it. If you want H, pay the price, rip. Speed, the same way. If you want a pistol and you want to turn loose of the money, you can get it.
How many are dead and are they all?
I say we have counted up to 21.
Are they all murdered?
Well, no. Several of them were smoke damaged, some were overdoses of drug, and some we do think were killed by the inmates.
We'll also identify, after we notify next of kin, with regards to the inmates that have been killed.
We need action. We need a group to come out and say, these people are alive. These people are dead.
In ABC's investigation of the riot, one of the most disturbing discoveries was that those in power in the New Mexico prison system at the time of the riot knew that it was being planned and did nothing to prevent it. Correspondent Sherman.
Our investigation shows that beginning 2 weeks before the killing started, inmate informants told guards, deputy wardens, even the prison psychologist, that a takeover was planned and that hostages would be taken. The information was accurate almost to the very day.
It was to be a disturbance to take over the whole penitentiary and kill all the snitches. The idea was to take all the females hostages, and Danny says, we have to tell somebody who it is, what's going on. So he went in and talked to Dr. Mark Warner. They were notified there was a potential hostage situation.
And ABC has obtained a series of confidential memos emphatically warning prison and state officials that a riot would take place. In this first memo, written 22 days before the prison exploded, Dr. Mark Orner, a prison psychologist, advised the head of prison security of a weapons buildup in dormitory E2 and of a potential hostage situation. In this memo, dated January 23rd, Deputy Warden Montoya told Warden Jerry Griffin that the takeover would occur shortly after the evening inmate count. Finally, on January 31st, 2 days before the riot, 13 key state officials, including Warden Griffin, members of the state police, and the Attorney General's staff met to discuss the warnings. In fact, 5 days before the riot, guards were briefed in large groups by their superiors about the warnings that had been gathered. Despite the meeting, despite all the warnings, extraordinarily enough, there was no additional staffing and no extra security precautions.
But before the riot, in fact, 48 hours before the riot, 15 men, including people from the state police, the attorney general's office, the warden of the prison itself, superior officers and so forth, met and discussed a report that this riot was going to...
Oh, I don't think that's right. That's your statement. You go ahead and quote your... Well, you quote your statements, and then I'll quote mine, okay?
I am quoting...
That is your statement. So let's let that be the record.
I am quoting directly from your...
Okay, well, you quote it then. I'm not quoting it because I don't know any of that to be a fact, okay?
Well, this is the Attorney General's...
Well, then you quote it. Read the Attorney General's report and do that and leave me out of it.
There were strong forecasts that this riot was going to occur. Now, does that conflict with the information that you have or have since obtained?
We had no knowledge that it was going to explode. Had I had any type of information or had any of my officials had it, well, we obviously would have brought in additional backup enforcements.
Correctional officers did know the riot was coming because about a week before it happened, Captain Baca came in and told us that it was happening, that he had caught two of the inmates with some documents saying when the riot was going to happen, how it was going to happen.
I had been warned by one of the students, if I come in one day and I tell you don't come to work the next day, you just damn well don't come to work the next day. It's for your own safety.
We asked former Attorney General Anaya why no precautions were taken.
I think probably it would have to be attributed to just a total lack of concern on the part of the prison administration. I don't think that any of them really believed that it was going to happen, or if it did, they felt they could probably keep it under control. But I think basically it all just points to the incompetence of the prison administration over a period of years.
Well, almost constant the definition. demonstrations going on inside the prison.
One of our demands now is that the five of us, the five that you've talked to, are in jeopardy right now. No matter what they say, once you people leave and they go in there, they're going to beat us and beat us bad.
I just put that on the camera,
and it's in the paper.
We will get the hostages out here.
Mr.
Okay,
Rose.
I have assured Colby Stevens, the two Durans, and Candelaria that they will be transferred out of state tomorrow.
The fact
also,
that,
wait a minute, also, that none of these other dudes here in this institution that have stayed behind
will be hurt.
No restitution,
no
segregation, no nothing.
All.
I'm going to tell you right now, you can't put people in cell block 3 because there's no cell block 3 there.
The negotiations between Rodriguez and key prison leaders, Colby, Stevens, and Candelaria, were coming to an end.
The inmates have agreed to surrender. The next problem is going to be what to do with 1,100 prisoners because this prison has been virtually destroyed.
Next, the retaking of the prison and the ultimate responsibility of New Mexico's politicians for the riot. On Sunday at 1:26 p.m., February 3rd, 36 hours after the riot began, the state retook the prison.
SWAT teams have moved in. No shots have been fired. The inmates have been ordered to come out the main lobby area and lie face down on the ground.
Most of the inmates had already surrendered. Some injured are suffering from drug overdoses. Only moments before, the last two hostages were released.
Is that absolutely clear? No shots fired.
He'll be okay. They'll find him outside, Mom. He'll be okay.
We want to see our family.
It was over. 33 convicts were dead, all murdered by other inmates. Not one of the 12 guards taken hostage was killed, but all were beaten, several were raped. Some were stabbed, and some so traumatized, doctors say they may never work again. The penitentiary was all but destroyed, burned, smashed, and flooded. The gymnasium, a charred shell. The offices gutted. Total damage, $25 million.
The blood and ashes of the New Mexico State Penitentiary riot soils the hands of the last three governors that we have had in the state of New Mexico.
Former Corrections Secretary John Salazar warned Governors Cargo, Apodaca, and King that changes had to be made at the prison.
I detailed these. None of these governors did anything about it. So in my judgment, they carry for the rest of their life the responsibility for what happened there.
The conditions were reported over and over again to people in power. Why then did three governors not intervene? Why did the state legislature not move to improve conditions? Officials naturally evade an uncomfortable issue, and New Mexico officials seem reluctant to take an initiative on this particularly unpopular issue, so long as the prisoners remain safely contained, unheard, and out of sight. Bruce King was governor from 1971 to 75 and began another term in 1979.
Why did it take this many grand jury reports, this many investigations, and finally a riot to make these changes?
Well, I don't think that that would be a fair assumption. I think from 71 through 74, that the prison was operated well.
King seemed to be saying that the prison deteriorated between 1975 and 79 under Governor Jerry Apodaca.
Aren't you throwing a little bit too much of the blame on Governor Jerry Apodaca?
And I don't think I'm throwing the blame on anyone. I'm just trying to bring the facts as the facts exist. And if you'd look, when I left office in 1974, I think you would find that there were about 800 prisoners in the institution. When I came back in 1979, there were 1,360-some-odd, so you see a great influx.
Governor Jerry Apodaca tried to change the prison system, but concedes he was not that successful.
Was there anything that stopped you from doing as much as you would have liked to in changing the way corrections was run?
Well, I guess the biggest thing is not having a blank check. You know, it's an expensive process.
you're talking about having to take that money from elsewhere.
Former Governor Apodaca says his problem was a lack of political support.
Who cares about the penitentiaries? The inmates? Well, how many inmates are there? Well, at its highest, what, 1,200, 1,300? You know, they can't even vote. You know, that's a very small constituency. Sure, they have families, they have friends, but sometimes the political pressures from the society outside of that arena is much greater.
And just as the governors do not accept blame for conditions at the prison, most state legislators also refuse responsibility.
So you blame the people who were managing that prison that night?
Of course. I wasn't out there managing it. I didn't want, not the one that went in and opened up the cell. I didn't leave the door open.
In New Mexico, year after year, you had grand juries going out to that penitentiary, and I'm sure you've seen that report, criticizing the conditions there.
You say that the legislature's seen it. That's not necessarily true. See, when you're coming in and on a long session, you're dealing with probably 1,100 pieces of legislation, and you can stay up to 2 or 3 in the morning, and one individual cannot be aware of all the different things that's going on.
Nobody in the legislature ever reads them. These are basically, as far as officialdom is concerned, just niceties of the law that are required to be done for the sake of following certain forms.
Sponsored bills for increasing of personnel, which was turned down. Sponsored bills for increasing their pay.
State Senator Manny Aragon has consistently supported prison reform. He thinks the legislature shares the blame for the riot.
And I believe that it's because that the powers that the people that were in power during this period of time are insensitive. Nor is it very popular to fight for penal reform and to argue for inmates' rights and things of that sort. I think people are very conservative, very punishment orientated. If you try to be reasonable with it, you become labeled liberal, progressive, radical, and not in tune with the sense of what the people of the state of New Mexico want.
On the day of their baptism, Thomas and Leo put on Christ. On the day of Christ coming.
In the climate of crisis following the riot, the state legislature did rush through the appropriation of more than $80 million. It called for a pay raise for correctional officers, an increase in staff, and created a 60-day training program for guards. The Attorney General, whose office is inundated with civil lawsuits, is conducting an exhaustive investigation of the riot. The state has been ordered by the courts to begin correcting abuses in the penitentiary. The atmosphere is one of recrimination.
Mr. King, Governor King, you work for the people. Yes, you mentioned that you came in here and you're working. Who do you work for?
Work with people in New Mexico.
Okay, the people are saying now, Governor King, we need accountability.
I fully know who I work for, and I'll continue to work for them, but there are 1,500,000 people in New Mexico, and I have no apologies to make for the operation that we ran. During the 4 years that I was here, I admit it could have been improved at times, but it was good operation. So, well, thank you all a lot. You're excused.
I still have
you're
one more.
You're excused. I'll write it out. Yeah.
You represent the whole state of New Mexico. So it's about time that Governor King says, yes, I will come to the people, and I will take care of their needs and their wants. Because this institution is people just like you, and I've seen them. I've seen people get beat up, grown men like you, and it's a shame.
For inmates still in the prison, response to the crisis has meant little real change. The Department of Corrections is still without a permanent director. Felix Rodriguez is back as acting warden. And the state seems most concerned with limiting its damages. The prisoners say conditions have not improved.
I get letters on a daily basis from inmates saying it's worse now than it was before the riot. It's festering in there, and the response of state government right now is to follow the advice of their insurance company and say, let's cut our losses. Don't anybody say anything that might come back to haunt us. Let's keep people from hearing.
You know, people who speak up in this state, you better be prepared for what results later. So people are afraid. They're afraid to talk. And so I'm afraid that the whole truth will not be known.
They have made threats on my life. My line rings all the time. And at one time, my daughter came to me, and she was crying and screaming. She says, they're after you, Dad. They want to kill you. A threat has been made. They told me to tell you, stop the investigation or else.
Bill Sherman, ABC News.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm good, you?
Can you tell me what the riot was like?
Madness.
Insanity.
All the things you dream about. That was it, you know.
Well, what's it like in here now?
Nothing's changed. You know, I mean, all of those people were part of the same thing that was here before the riot and been here for 20 years. You know, they're scared to death to change. You know, they figure change means their job.
And that is finally part of the classic story offered by what happened in New Mexico. A cycle of public indifference that needs so monstrous a cry as a riot to even stir it to attention. That, followed by an ebbing back into despair that bred the riot. And public indifference again. This year, there have been convulsions in prisons and jails across the country, in Idaho, in New Jersey, in Virginia, New York, and Hawaii, in Washington and Indiana, where inmates were killed and injured. The question is, will this tragic cycle repeat itself forever? The only promise for its being interrupted lies in those few who care.
Everything came to me immediately that could I have prevented this from happening? Could I, in any way, have done something then that would have saved the lives of 33 inmates, that could have saved the maiming and the scars that this has left in our state? To this day, I still wonder if I, as a public official, could not have done more.
At 28 minutes after 7 o'clock, you're listening to KUNM, and it's Hot Licks. And don't forget, you got to get your dedications in.
This is Armando Cuerva at Mexico State Penitentiary, and I'd like to dedicate this song to all those people that are pulling for us for prison reform, taking an interest in our cause.
Tell me why.
This has been a presentation of ABC News.